Line is clear.
Wildland firefighters confront increasingly hazardous conditions each year. The use of aerial support has become more critical than ever. Ensuring the line is clear is vital when working with aerial resources. In this module, we will speak with aerial firefighting experts to discuss how to utilize aerial resources safely, effectively, and efficiently. Learning objectives, aerial operations, target description, hazards, line is clear, crew safety, feedback.
We're managing the deconfliction of airspace, the number of aircraft that we have, tail numbers, and operations, progressing on suppression.
Brevity is critical. So we have a lot of hard scripts built in, and even the conversations we have in the air are very pertinent, very relevant, very brief, very concise. For that reason. And while ground firefighters sometimes have to have a conversation, if they just keep that in the back of their mind, that we have so much radio dialogue going on and that they can strive to do the same, just maintain that brevity.
Beam the, just prior to the dead tree right here, 1400 feet, at 005 degrees, average level 3, stop prior to the trees. Big trees on the exit.
A lot of times the air crew can hear the air attack discussing ground objectives with the IC or a division, and a lot of times we can hear, hey, the VLAT is inbound. We're going to work on that line we had discussed. And for us, that's our cue right away that that line is starting to get cleared. That gives us a good feeling as we're approaching, because one, we can hear the work area. We know there's good communication with ground crew and that the ground is starting to clear. And when we get on scene, we'll most likely just be ready to go right to work.
Stand by.
Stand by.
Dropping.
That is the traffic.
Stop.
Target description.
Avoiding cardinal directions and using fire anatomy and landmarks are more constant and more reliable. Less room for error.
And that's as basic as heel, head, left flank, right flank, left shoulder, right shoulder.
A placard or a panel or flagging on your tool handle is great for walking in a helicopter. From 2,500 feet or from fast moving aircraft, it's maybe a little bit harder to see. Mirror flashes are great, but they're limited to sunshine only and a certain angle. Strobes are money. Much of what we do when we want to clear the line is first we have to identify who is where, what the contact is, and where exactly are they. Good communication, good target description of where you're at adds to the picture of knowing where crews are when they say they're clear. As far as the risks, order what you need and we'll sort that out. If we can't do it, then we'll come up with the next best solution.
Hazards.
In terms of when to relay information about a hazard, there's no better time than the present, as soon as possible. Two big ones that I've seen over the years is wind and smoke or visibility. And so oftentimes folks on the ground are thinking it's too windy or we don't have the visibility to bring aircraft. Like Kurt's saying, if you have a need for it, you order air attack up, we can size that up and determine definitively if it's a go or no go. A prime example is low, small power lines, telephone wires that we might not be able to see. And oftentimes those telephone poles, I mean, they're standing straight up. So when we're looking down at 2,500 feet, they're nearly invisible to us. So if you see those on the ground, notify us right away. And we can relay that to the other pilots and everybody's on the same page.
No factor. And just south of the structures is a set of high tension power lines.
Okay, I'm
look at all these.
By the heel on the east side.
I didn't see anybody on the ground in there either. It'd be clear to drop.
Line is clear.
When we hear line is clear, we're expecting it to be clear. If we do get a flash of yellow, we're just gonna go around. We'll take it around. But that doesn't mean that it could be at a point where we're already dropping and that individual's already at risk. It's very important when the ground says the line is clear, it's clear. If that tanker pilot is low on the drop, there's a good chance that that retardant will be coming at you with forward velocity, and that's what's dangerous. That's what's gonna hurt you. That's what will break limbs at treetop heights and cause hazards to impact you. You should never take for granted that it's just gonna be raining on you, because terrain is not level under the drop. It's rising and descending. And if you're on the rise, you could be closer to the retardant coming out of the aircraft, in which it might not be raining straight down.
So if at any point there's confusion or hesitation on where that line is going to be placed exactly and whether it's clear, we'll just provide a show me and do a dry run.
Crew safety.
I think the most challenging is probably that first drop as well, right? And so maybe giving it a little bit more room than anticipated on that first drop. Just there on the side of caution never hurts. After that, if it's tag and extend or they're rolling up into it, it's a little more predictable where that line's gonna be.
Trying to build some understanding of what resources are what. Hopefully you know what the next fixed wing retardant delivery is coming from. And if it's a seat, a lat, or a VLAT, that increases your situational awareness and adds to your common sense to where the most appropriate place to clear the line is.
There's no hard number on distance that you need to be away from a drop. A lot of it's situation dependent. Some other good talking points or factors is being perpendicular to the drop, if you can, uphill or above the drop. Oftentimes the hazard doesn't come from just what's coming out of the aircraft, but what it might be hitting, snags, widowmakers, rocks coming loose, rolling down the hill. So those are other factors in terms of clearing the line that you want to consider.
It's not worth the risk putting yourself in danger to get a good video of a tanker dropping or a helicopter dropping. Not only are you putting yourself in danger, but if that aircraft has to go around, it impacts the entire ballet that is going on to fight that fire. And that could mean losing a fire, it could mean a home being burnt. So it's not worth the temptation to jeopardize your clearance to the line, to get those views and those likes, and forget that we're there to fight fire.
Mm-hmm. If there is a go around or the line's not clear, that means a mistake was made. Well, that's fine, we own it, but it's preventable, right? So that's what we're trying to do, is when that line's clear, it's clear and we go to work. When crews are working with helicopters, that feedback is going to be direct to the helicopter pilot. Oftentimes with retardant or tanker drops, if anybody's got feedback to provide, we'll take it. That can come in the form of the drop was early, the drop was late, It didn't tie in. Maybe one wing to the left, move the line one wing to the right. And another one that's really helpful and oftentimes missed is the coverage level on the ground. So we can see it from the air if the line's good, and we can see the red retardant drop, but oftentimes we can't compare that with the fuel loading on how tall that grass is, how much duff there is, how thick the timber is. Is that retardant even making it to the ground, or is it getting hung up in the canopy? That feedback is pretty critical. We might ask for it, we might not, but if you have something to relay to help us provide a better service, we'll take it.
It's a very professional environment up there, and feedback's encouraged. With brevity, with conciseness, mission tempo being a factor, that's a conversation.
Final thoughts.
Again, aircraft is a force multiplier, and ultimately, we're all out there with the same goal. We, as air attacks and as pilots, work for the resources on the ground. We want to coordinate and collaborate as best we can to be safe, effective, and efficient.
Now you understand what it means for a line to be clear. Apply this lesson in the field to help us all return home safely.